Hey everyone, I finished watching the next VR Troopers episode. I don't remember the name of it. I'll look it up later. Probably something to do with dogs or something. I'll look it up now, it's right here. What's it called? Dogmatic Change. Oh, that's awful. Okay, anyway. Let's see, it starts off with Ryan and JB accompanying Caitlin to an animal shelter. Caitlin's taking pictures of animals for some newspaper article. Grimlord is spying on them, and he gets the idea to turn all the animals there into his own mutant army. So, then he calls on Icebot, and Icebot's like, I have this magic potion, sir, and it can turn animals into mutant monsters. And Grimlord's like, cool, good enough, and... So then, at Tau Dojo, Caitlin gets a call from Carl Zichter pretending to be some guy with a weird accent. Yeah, Carl Zichter puts on a weird accent here. I kind of wonder why he didn't just get one of the Skugs to do it. Whatever, anyway. He pretends that he's some executive at a dog food company, and he wants Caitlin to be a director for a new ad campaign. So, then Caitlin's like, I know just the one who's good for it, and so I was expecting her to go back to the animal shelter and get one of the dogs they kept showing, but no, she asks Jeb. Yeah, forget about the animal shelter until the end of the episode, it doesn't really come back. So anyway, Jeb's kind of excited to be, yeah, I'd love to be in a commercial. And so then, Grimlord reveals to his minions his plans, and one of the Skugs is disguised. And he's gonna go and put the mutating potion into Jeb's dog food, and then a transporter will transport Jeb to Grimlord, and he has this computer monitor thing that he can control Jeb monster with. He doesn't. Or maybe he does, but we don't see it. Whatever, moving on. Let's see. Oh, I skipped over a lot in my notes here. Holy crap. Okay, so in the episode, we actually see them setting up for the commercial, which they don't actually record anything. They just set up a backdrop. They have Jeb there. They have the food there. They have the dog food, like, branding everywhere. Oh, and it's called Doggy Delicious or something. And it's a really lazy logo. Like, wow, they didn't even try. They just picked whatever the first font that looked weird was and was like, good enough. it's fine. It has, like, that kind of, like, 90s feel to it, where it's, like, it's acceptable for a goofy sitcom show. It's just kind of weird to see it in what's supposed to be an adventure sci-fi show. So anyway, the Skug that's disguised puts the potion into Jeb's food. He gives him the food. He eats it. Caitlin takes pictures. They don't record it. I feel like maybe her suspicion should have been piqued when they didn't actually have a crew there to record. Whatever. Moving on. Let's see. So later on, Jeb is acting weird. He runs off, and then Smythe is the, like, fake name of the disguised Skug. Okay. So then he teleports Jeb away, and for some reason Jeb's collar doesn't teleport with him. Even though it's there later, whatever. Anyway, Ryan runs up, he sees the guy holding Jeb's collar, what'd you do with my dog? And then the guy turns into a couple of Skugs, they fight off the Skugs for a while, and then, let's see, oh yeah, they get, because they know it's Smythe, the disguised Skug, they're like, they know that he has some association with Grimlord or whatever, so they're like, wait a minute, the dog food bowl, we can take that to Hart's lab and have it analyzed, which is a smart move. Good on them for figuring that out. So then they take the dog food bowl to Hart's lab, and then, let's see, meanwhile, Jeb gets mutated into a monster, and funny, he keeps the Jack Nicholson voice. They don't, like, try to monster it up or anything, it's just kind of his normal voice. It's, like, slightly more growly, I guess, but... not even, like, that much has changed. It's kind of funny. So then, let's see. Grimlord orders Jeb, Monster, Jeb, whatever. They don't really give it a name after he mutates, whatever. He tells them to release the animals from the animal shelter, but then Jeb goes to the zoo. He's not very good at taking orders, I guess. So then the troopers are at Hart's lab, and they see Jeb trying to release animals from the zoo. And so then Ryan goes after Jeb, while JB and Caitlin go to stop Grimlord from making more mutation potions. So, airship footage, which I'm kind of getting tired of at this point. It happens nearly every episode where they're like, somebody has to go in the airship, because we can't all go together. Even though here it seems like it would have been fine if they used the American suits. Like, they have the suits. Like, for the troopers, at least. It seems like they could utilize those a little bit. Or at least the battle grid. Though, like, the battle grid wouldn't really fit in this episode, but... moving on. Let's see. Ryan encounters Jeb. He's trying to get him to remember who he is, and then... this is really weird, and I'm guessing it makes more sense in Matalder. He asks Professor Hart to send a virtual... or, no, he just says send a dog, because maybe if Jeb sees another dog, he'll remember who he is. So Hart sends a virtual dog. I don't know why it had to be a virtual dog, because again, the animal shelter at the beginning. I kept thinking, oh, Hart is gonna, like, see a dog at the animal shelter that Jeb had, like, looked at or something, and that would, like, trigger a memory, but no, it's virtual dog, and what's the virtual dog do? Hey, yo, look, I'm a dog, get it? Woof. And then Jeb's like, ah, I remember now, I'm not a monster, I'm a dog, like you, and... okay. That conflict was pretty easily resolved. And then a monster shows up, shoots Jeb with this foamy stuff that's supposed to disintegrate him, but instead it just turns him back into Jeb. Convenient. And, like, fine, it works. It's weird, though. The footage is, like, pretty intense. Oh, and also, when Jeb is mutating, you see kind of a silhouette, and the dog in the silhouette has pointed ears. Jeb doesn't have pointed ears. He has, like, floppy hound dog ears. So I'm guessing that was the dog from Matalder. They did have, like, a talking dog, kind of, in Matalder. He had, like, a radio around his neck or something that he could talk through, like Mr. Mind from the old Shazam comics. Remember? Anybody know that? Anyway, I've heard that, like, something bad happens to the dog, and I'm wondering if it was in this episode. Does that monster actually kill the dog in Matalder? What was that? Oh, sounded like something fell over back here. Which, I mean, stuff did, but not now, from what I... whatever. Back to the thing. The footage of Ryan and the Jeb monster is so intense, I'm getting the feeling that this was probably a lot more meaningful and, like, relevant in Matalder than it is here. Here, it's just another one-off episode. Doesn't really connect to anything, doesn't really mean anything. Don't really know what else to say about the plot here, anyway. Jeb's back to normal. I guess JB and Caitlin accomplished whatever. Grimlord can't try again because Amiratoku rules. He can only try this idea once, or maybe twice if they think of it again later on. So then the ending is when we finally get back to the animal shelter. The mayor and his wife are there to announce, like, this expansion of the animal shelter. And Mrs. Rooney, the mayor's wife, insults Jeb for not really any reason. She's just a jerk. Like, in this episode, it doesn't even really appear like she knows who Jeb is. Like, this could just as well be their first encounter. Like, if this episode had happened to air before the other two or three times, whatever, how many times they met before. So anyway, Jeb takes her purse, tosses it in one of the kennels, she goes in to get it, and he shuts the door on her, and she's locked in the kennel. Ha ha ha. The end. It's fine. It's an okay episode, but I feel like a lot more could have been done with it. But I think the biggest, thing holding it back is just the simple, like, practicality. They don't have the monster suit. I think if they had the monster suit, in a lot of cases with VR Troopers, I feel like there is a lot more they could have done with this. I think they could have had a far more personal story with Ryan and Jeb, but because of the footage that was available, they couldn't really dive super deep into it. like, they had to keep it simple. They had to keep it just, Grimlord mutates Jeb, Jeb's a monster now, Ryan is trying to get through to him, we have to work in the dog that he sees, because it's all the footage we have to work with. But that makes me wonder, why didn't they utilize the animal shelter more? Why didn't, at the beginning, they have Jeb, like, go up to one of the kennels, and he, like, knows one of the dogs there, or he's talking to one of the dogs there. And I don't mean talking in his Jack Nicholson voice, but I mean, like, just interacting as a dog to the other dog. And so then, like, I don't know, maybe they couldn't find a dog that matched the dog in the Japanese footage? But, like, I don't know, is it really that hard to find, what was it, like, a little Saint Bernard-looking dog? I don't know quite, I don't know dog breeds, so whatever, but I feel like they could have easily found one and worked this into the, like, plot better. As it is, I don't know what the animal shelter even does. It doesn't serve any purpose. It's just there at the beginning, it's there at the end. You could swap out the middle with nearly anything. This, whatever. It's one of the other issues I have with VR Troopers is there's a lot of times where they have footage that just feels like it's filler, like it could just be put in anywhere. Which might actually be true, considering what they did with Power Rangers. And Power Rangers, there were, like, scenes, I'm pretty sure, that they shot with the intention that they could be anywhere. So I'm wondering if they did the same thing with VR Troopers, although it feels a little clunkier here. So anyway, one of the things I do like about this episode, compared to other episodes, is the whole bit with the mayor's wife. I'm not really a big fan of her. I'm glad that, if I remember right, her role gets smaller and smaller, and her and the mayor eventually just stop appearing altogether. I do like how it's handled here a little bit more, because she's the aggressor towards Jeb. Jeb is just pranking her back for being a jerk. So it kind of works. It doesn't put Jeb in quite a bad light. It's not confusing, like some of the other ones, where he just seems to knock her over or push her into something just 'cause. And that's about it for this one. The only other thing that I want to say about this episode is I think it's cool they gave Jeb his own episode. I think that's pretty cool for a side character like that to get their own focus. It doesn't go super deep into his character or anything. He's not that deep of a character. He's a dog who talks with a Jack Nicholson voice, and he just kind of shows up when he needs to. Oh yeah, and also, let's see, one of the things with Jeb that's kind of weird is, like, the effect they would use for, like, him to blow raspberries at people. They would have, like, the dog that plays Jeb stick his tongue out, and then just add a pfft noise and, like, freeze frame. I don't really know who thought that was a good idea. I don't know, maybe it's not supposed to look good, it's just supposed to be silly. I don't know, sometimes humor is, like, weird for me. I don't always get the joke, so I don't really know if it was actually, like, they were trying to be funny and it just isn't, or if it is funny and I just don't get it. Like, maybe it's supposed to not look good, or it's supposed to be kind of awkward and weird, because the show itself is kind of awkward and weird. Whatever, moving on, that's about it for this one, so hope you enjoyed it. See ya.